Hi everyone, welcome to another exciting comics loving edition of Words, Images, and Worlds. On this episode, I am delighted to be talking with comics creator, author, writer Joshua Dysart. Joshua, thank you for jumping in, joining, and talking with me for a few minutes.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's gonna
It
be
is a
fun.
pleasure. Yeah,
Cool.
absolutely. I usually start by mentioning a couple of titles. You have several, Harbinger being one of those, as well as some work in Bloodshot in the world of Valiant. You've done some interesting work for Image. You've done DC's Demon and Swamp Thing, and just a host of material. Unknown Soldier also being one of my favorites.
Nice.
So you've created in a range of worlds and some really interesting storytelling.
Cool.
Curious, what makes comics this unique creating space for you?
There's pragmatic reasons and then there's, lofty reasons. I mean, pragmatically, I struggled to become a professional storyteller in the 90s, and I was a child who grew up with 80s comics. I'm a child of like 85, 86, 1985, 1986, when a bunch of really big, sort of notorious comic books dropped and deeply impacted me. And so in the 90s, before we all had phones and before there was an internet, there was only really one way to visually tell a story that wasn't financially, impossible, and that was to get into comics. So I sort of f went from just kind of loving them and feeling relatively well versed in them to trying to understand how to make them in the 90s. As far as the lofty reasons why comics, which have kind of come to me over the years as I've worked on them, I mean, I'm really excited about how much they empower the reader. I think a reader who is engaging with a comic book has total control of time and space in a way. Novels are dictatorial. You like march one word after another. It's very difficult to kind of to use like really modern language to hyperlink around a novel. You've got it's very dense, the amount of text. A movie, nothing's more dictatorial than a movie. You're just literally being marched along at 24 frames a second or 60 frames a second or whatever it is they shot it in. Same with video games. And so in a way, comics is the only place where the reader is in control of time and the reader is in control of space. They can stop and linger on a moment. As they can rush ahead. They have a lot of control over what they imagine is happening between the panels. Famously, we all talk about when we are talking about these about formal things like this, we all talk about Superman never flies. He flies between the panels. I think all of that is really exciting and engaging, especially now when our media has become so impressive and so easy to create that it can sometimes feel like it's hampering the imagination. I really love that about it. As I said, as a young creator, it was cost effective. I know now we all have movie studios in our phones, which is really exciting and super democratizing, and I love it. But still, though, if you want to blow up the world, the cheapest way to do it is to draw it on the page. It's still like the best way to do it. So I think that's really important. And then there's also I just have come over the years to learn about how comic books impact the mind of the reader in a way that's different than other media. In the last century, before we became extremely like for lack of a better term, like sequentially art literate or whatever, comics were considered by both bad fat bad faith actors and good faith actors to be the best form of propaganda. The United States dropped comic books all over Southeast Asia when we were militarily involved in Vietnam and Cambodia and killing millions of innocent people. And and governments have done this all over the world. So there is something about a comic book that immediately like pierces any literacy veil or any language barrier that I find super, super interesting. If you get on a plane, the documentation that tells you how to get out alive in case it's a crash is a comic book. The I just find this really, really interesting the way that it engages with the human mind. And when I suppose we'll talk about it in a second, but when I ended up working with the United Nations World Food Program in places like East Africa and stuff, places that were destabilized and either had a lot of different people speaking a lot of different languages due to forced migration and movement of the people, or places with low literacy rates because of, you know, disruptions. We made comics through the United Nations World Food Program, and those comics taught people how to prepare for food drops or how to use the World Food Program vouchers that would allow them to purchase food in places. So, you know, I just find comic books so fascinating in their egalitarianism and how they and what they do to the human mind. It's something beyond literacy. You know, it's something different. It's a new kind of literacy. And then lastly, I'm really excited about them formally in the sense of like, you know, everything. Comic books has three separate narratives happening at once. And ideally, when you're really, really landing it, you're synergistically making them all say a singular thing. And other mediums do this, but they do it, but they have to be experimental to do it. And for us, it's our natural state of being. So like if my text says one thing and my image says another thing, there becomes a third meaning, right? That just emerges from this collusion. So like if it says, you know, if it's a portrait of a man smiling and the text says it was the worst day of his life, some third meaning has emerged, right? And every medium can do this, but they have to stretch further than we do, I think. So I love that too, that formal nature of it. I think that's my answer.
I love that answer. And I was thinking about, I was thinking about how, you know, oftentimes I'll have students who don't speak English as their first language. And I'm very monolingual. I try to learn Spanish, try to learn other languages. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit of ancient Greek in there because of a Bible degree I once did. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's pretty limited over here. So I love how attracted they seem to be to comics and sharing in comics. And it really is that democratizing thing of we've got the image, we've got the text, we've got these things working together. And if one system isn't working, you've got the other system working there, kind of supporting and working in tandem. And I love that idea of a third meaning too.
Yeah, absolutely. I suffered from a pretty severe learning disability. I mean, it's something I will always have, but it was the mid and late 70s when I was diagnosed with it in South Texas, which wasn't even then the most progressive place in the world. And, you know, and comics played a huge role before I eventually found a special educator who would work with me for many, many, many years, and teach me how to read. Comics played a really important role in me staying excited about stories and reading, so that I could push through this. I was just having more difficulty learning to read than everyone around me. So that can either break you, or you can find a reason to push through and, like, you know, work twice as hard. And I think comics provided that for me. So it's really important. Yeah.
Well, and I think from somebody that spends time in the classroom, anybody that learns differently or anybody that takes some time to develop anything gets sort of labeled or pushed as disabled in some way. Yes. There's some disability there when sometimes it's just a matter of difference.
I think, I'm probably not the best person to speak on this. I'm sure I'm still laboring under a lot of my own prejudices and thinking about it, but is there neurotypical? Is that even a thing? Like, you know, at one point we stopped talking about, like, there are no normal families. Is there really a neurotypical mind? I get that some people are better at certain things than others, you know, but I think we need to broaden our understanding of how each individual person learns, you know. And I was definitely the victim of an education system that took a lot of its cues from assembly lines, you know, instead of like treating us like human beings, like organic human beings who are like each one engaging with the material in a different way. So comics somehow cuts through that. And I, you know, we could probably write a paper on why and how, but it just does.
Yeah. Well, and I love that creative path that's there. And it doesn't always get present. It doesn't always get presented and visible in the factory model, in the factory reality.
Absolutely. But, yeah. I mean, the one of the frustrating things and why I don't really like to celebrate too much like particular writers or whatever is that it's inherent in our species to be storytellers. And we you can really cobble a young person's ability to come into their own as a storyteller. And stories are how we interface with the world. It's how we interface with each other. So,
absolutely. And with that idea of storytelling in mind, is there a particular kind of story that you are drawn to tell or that speaks to you?
Well, lots of different kinds of stories speak to me, but there probably is particular kinds of stories that I am drawn to tell. I'm sort of in love with all stories, but there's a few key factors that I like to have. I'm sort of a radical humanist. And so I want to see I need humanism in my stories. And it doesn't matter how fantastical they are or how genre they are. I mean, I adore genre, but the story really needs to be concerned with, and the story can even be cruel. You know, it can be violent. I mean, I kind of love exploitation, which is inherently icky in a way. But it still has to be humanist, though. You still have to be either through a satirical lens or an earnest lens. You still have to be saying something about the human condition. Like, we're all here to just talk about what it means to be human. It's a very complex thing to be. It has its cruelties and it has its beauties. And that is precisely why we use stories to interface with its complexity. So if you're not doing that, I'm probably not terribly interested unless you're super formally interesting, because I am obsessed with form. And so you're either, and that could be genius or like art brute, like this person barely knows how to do it. And so somehow they're doing it in a way I've never seen before. I love that too. I love gross incompetence is really exciting, I think. Like committed to it, you know, committed to the bit, gross incompetence. So formalism always attracts me a lot. And then I guess the only other thing I'm really looking for is a creator or a storyteller to just be conscious and aware of like the small moments that make up our lives. I don't want everything to be a big beat. I don't want everything to push the plot forward. There's so much advice in like writing books and stuff that I just cannot stand. That's so cringy to me, you know, because they're like, I want to see characterological expression. I want my characters, they don't have to be good people or bad people or kind people or angry people, but they do have to be people. And that has to be expressed through some sort of characterological exercise in the work. And I want little things, you know, I mean, how many times did we like, we're walking to work and we're harried and we're hurried and suddenly we catch like dew light in a spider's web or something and it stops us. It's impossible to know why that's beautiful to us. I mean, we could wax on about it, but we don't really know what it's doing to the human mind. But if the story isn't wrestling with that on some level, then it better be formally crazy and stupid and fun. Those are the things I'm looking for, I think, and are certainly looking for when I write. I'm pretty open to enjoying a lot of different kind of stuff. I don't like treacly things. I don't like things that are dishonest emotionally. That's about it.
No cloying.
I don't like it. I could buy into it but you better really be cloying. You better like commit. You better commit, yo. I like commitment.
Are you a Vonnegut fan?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
How is one not?
Right.
I mean, you know, Vonnegut really, you know, there's that famous, it was a really impactful for me when I very first saw it. And now it's been on YouTube for ages. And I hope every young writer has seen it. But his very quick, brief speech on story shape. Everybody needs to see it. It blows my mind when I start discussing story shape with an editor or another writer or somebody. And they don't grok what I'm throwing down, you know? And that's frustrating because story shape to me is like the secret to unlocking structure, and structure is super important. So
yeah, that form is definitely there for sure. And I was wondering, as you've created, getting to collaborate in comics must be a constantly rewarding process. Anybody whose form and approach has just sort of blown you away, recognizing that you can't name everybody, but anybody that sort of bubbles to the top of that.
Well, you know, the answer to this is like, I have been really fortunate in my career and worked with so many people. So it would be a really, really long list. Mm-hmm. I hate to leave people out, of course, but I learned from everybody. I learned a great deal from Mike Mignola when Mike and I were working together in the Hellboy universe. He taught me a lot about thinking like an artist, because I'm not an artist, and it can be, there can be a disability in not being an artist and working in comics. And so you have to be, you know, really humble. It's very humbling to not be an artist and work in comics. So Mike taught me a lot. I mean, the list is endless. Cliff Chang, Enrique Breccia. But I think that the person that I like working with, that's most fulfilling, I don't know if it's the most educational, but is, you know, Alberto Ponticelli and I, Alberto, who did Unknown Soldier with me, and then some of the United Nations work. And now we're continuing to do stuff. Our last book was called Orc Island. You know, I've been working with him now. We started together in 2007, and we just had a book come out mid last year. So that's, you know, I've been working with this guy forever. That's really, really exciting. And it allows, you know, when you work with somebody like Cliff Chang, who's an absolute genius, but you only do one project with them, there's so much left on the table, right? That didn't get, there's so many other options and choices you could have made, but that's what you made. But with Alberto, we get to grow together and we get to try new things. And if Alberto is sick of doing one thing, you know, for years we were kind of doing, up until about Goodnight Paradise, Alberto and I were doing a kind of like kitchen sink, like social drama comics. You know, based in real places and in the real world. And, you know, And he was sick of it, and I don't blame him. And so now it's all like we're doing like big fantasy work together and stuff. And that's a really exciting relationship. Sorry, my phone popped off. That's a really exciting relationship to have with somebody. And then I think also my relationship with Jonathan Dumont at the World Food Program, we haven't gotten to work together a lot, but I think we will work together more. And that leads to like a larger thing, which is the work in out in the world. And that's not a person, but those are definitely the most important experiences of my life. Being in Uganda in 2007 and traveling with child soldiers during the ceasefire between the LRA and the UPDF, and then being in Iraq in 2014 during the rise of ISIS or Daesh, and then being in, you know, South Sudan during the civil war in 2016. So those experiences are really profound. And ultimately the work is exciting and fun to have, and it's nice to put things out there and for people to see, but the life is making the work. That's the thing. If the book comes out bad or good, I don't know. You do your best, and you know, you throw it out in the world, and you don't know if people are reading it or if they're liking it or whatever. That doesn't matter. What matters is the experience you had with the people that you made the book with. And
but I imagine having experiences like that, Iraq, Uganda, and the work that you've done, you can't not have those things mingle into the work in some way, even if it's a project that's not necessarily about that.
100%. That trip, that first trip, it wasn't my first time in a low impact guerrilla war zone. That trip to northern Uganda in 2007 to Acholi Land, Uganda, was not my first time in a combat zone, but it was the first time that I really was unprotected, was moving freely, and became deeply, emphatically moved by the civilian population that was, and I walked away from that with my entire focus of my life changed and really refocused on what value human beings have in a geopolitical framework, which is zero. And inside the machinations of geopolitics, human beings have zero value, right? Or their value rises and falls based on the geopolitical scenarios around them. And that just became so intolerable to me and so unacceptable. And I've always been a very politically minded person and a bit of a politics junkie, but I'm so sick of like isms over people, you know, or mm-hmm. or politics mm-hmm. over people. So that changed me considerably. And and all my work now has some, even when I'm trying to be escapist, which is there's no escape. I don't even believe in escapism, frankly, but even when I'm trying, you know, I'm still constantly concerned with the plight of the human being in face of massive geopolitical maneuverings. You know, it's whether that's poverty in the United States with the homeless issue, or it's bombs dropping on children. You know, I don't give a shit what your politics are. If your political end means you have to drop a bomb on a child, we need to rethink the whole thing. So that became like the sole focus really of my work. Even when I'm trying to be distanced from it, it's still in there.
Well, as somebody that looks at the world in a human-centered lens, and I'm right there with you in thinking about the human at the center and those humanist kind of tenets, so much of that is involved in storytelling. One would hope, one would think that so much of politics would be as well. I mean, right. Politics doesn't, that refers to people, I believe, yes. That word.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting because you're absolutely right in the escapism aspect too. We read stories that are not about us, that are really about us.
Right.
That we just sort of look at and go, oh, wait a second. That really is something I should think about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, Michael Bay can make movies about robots beating the shit out of each other or beating each other up. Sorry.
You're fine.
Oh, cool. You know, but. And it might feel like it's escapism, but there's something jingoistic at the heart of it. There's something techno-fetishist at the heart of it. We're not going to get away from meaning. And you know what I mean? It's not going to happen.
Even that scene in Everything Everywhere All at Once where they become rocks, they're humanized rocks. I mean, they become
precisely.
Like people. So, I mean, it's always going to be there. Unless there's some form of entertainment that exists for another species we're not aware of, it's going to be anthropomorphized in some way.
Yes, precisely. And, you know, in many ways, this is like we've been trying to like negate our desire to anthropomorphize the world around us for so long. But one of the things we did is, I mean, mostly because it was important for our species survival to enslave other species. But one thing I think our humanization of the world around us, whether it's fictional or not, is starting to do is like we need to start rethinking our relationship to other species, you know, and like we kind of, you know, kind of need to be calling everybody a person, sort of, so that because when you if your dog's not a person, then you can do harm to your dog. And that's what we're doing to our environment and our world. So I'm okay with anthropomorphizing rocks. It doesn't seem to be causing a lot of harm, but yeah, it's definitely in our nature. Totally.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I see a guitar back there. Is music also part of your process?
Music is a huge part of my process. I'm not very good with that instrument. There's been guitars in my life all my life because my uncle, who, and let's not labor on this, just passed away a few days ago. But he was a honky-tonk musician in Texas, played his first, you know, honky-tonk when he was 12 years old. And so he was one of the main figures who raised me. So I've grown up my whole life with like honky-tonk country music all around me and stuff. So there's always been guitars in my life, but I'm not very good at them. But I will say, if the question is just music in general all around me, music is a huge part of my life and a massive part of my creative process. If I'm not going for a walk listening to music, you know, then I'm probably not really doing the work on my story that I need to be doing. That's my primary process away from the keyboard.
And what a great way to pass on stories that way too, because if there's
Yes.
one medium and one message system that you can't get out of your head, I mean,
Yes.
yeah, that's why I can go an entire year and occasionally hum a song from Dirty Dancing, which is an embarrassing but true fact.
That's
Embarrassing but
own
true.
it. Own
That's
it.
right. That's right. I've anyway, I better not sing all that, or I'll have to like pay something to
Yeah,
somebody.
exactly. You'll
So.
get but yeah, I mean I say this all the time and I thoroughly believe it. And but you know, music is the voice of God. Like there's something, it's the one thing that we do that that somehow touches the ephemeral. You know, everything
Yeah.
else is kind of, yeah, stories sort of, but music really does something different. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I'm thinking, and I'm about to get to our last question, but now I'm thinking about the Silmarillion and
Yes.
Tolkien and yeah, that musical language, absolutely. So my last official question, we can hit anything that we've missed, of course, but you mentioned a couple of projects that are in development. And so going to the idea of what's on the way that you can talk about. I know that sometimes those things are under sealed containers and things like that.
Sure.
But anything there and any place where people can sort of follow along.
Yeah, sure. Well, the follow along thing, I am currently on Twitter, but I'm miserable there, so I don't know what I'm gonna do. I don't know, like social media is such a hellscape at this point. There's no real safe space. But you can find me there as it stands now. And if you like movies, I'm on Letterboxd as well.
Nice.
Which is probably where I am most of the time. As far as projects go, I have something coming up. We did have a title for it, and then we found out that that title was already taken. So we have to rename it. So unfortunately, I wish I could title check it for you, but it's with David Laugham and I. David Drawing, who did the amazing Stray Bullets. And if anybody listening to this has never engaged with Stray Bullets, you absolutely should.
Absolutely.
Incredible, amazing work of American comics. And he and I have a four issue, each issue though is like 40 pages, 40, 50 pages, horror story coming out hopefully this year, I think. Yeah, this year. And that's going to be really exciting. And that'll be through Bad Idea Comics. And I wish I could tell you the title, but I literally don't know what it is anymore. So
We'll
we're
put it in the show notes if we can find
yes, sure,
it.
sweet. We'll
Absolutely.
figure it out. Yeah. So that's the only thing I have coming up that I can really talk about. I'm definitely working on a bunch of other stuff, but it's not really ready to see the light of day. So I would just refer back to some of my more recent work if people are interested. Goodnight Paradise is a graphic novel, a murder mystery that takes place in Venice Beach during a period of rapid gentrification, about a homeless or houseless person who is sort of unconsciously solving a mystery of a murder mystery, and really proud of that. That was in competition at Angoulême last year for best mystery graphic novel in the world, which we did not win. But super excited to be in
That's good
competition.
company. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Absolutely.
I'm really proud of that work. That's with Alberto Ponticelli, and that's through TKO Publishing, TKO Press. My first novel came out at the beginning of last year. That's called Brood X. It's only 100
Yes.
pages. It's a novella. People can read it if you like. It's kind of like Agatha Christie meets slasher, 80s slasher meets like bugs and construction sites. I don't know how to pitch it, but that's what it is. And then my most recent single issue comic is Orc Island through Bad Idea, also with Alberto Ponticelli. So those are the three books I'm flogging right now.
Love it, love it. So much
Sweet.
out there to check out,
Dude,
including the
I'm churning.
pros.
I'm grinding.
I love it. I love it.
Mean, what do you got to pay the rent, you know?
Well, and I imagine also the creating doesn't stop, right? Like the desire to get those words and ideas out there is just it flows.
Yes, it does. It does. I wish I could say that you know that it's all this kind of ecstatic like
Oh, right.
expression
Yeah.
all the
Yeah.
time, but you know I'm very off, you know there are economic realities in my life, but I am fortunate that I may not always be writing the thing I most want to write in that moment, but I have gotten to a place where I pretty much get to do what I want to do for the most part, and the only thing that holds me back is my own, you know, myself, my insecurities, my self-doubts,
Right.
and my inabilities. I'm a
Yes.
shackled man.
Yet another part of humanity. Absolutely.
Yeah, precisely.
We could totally dive into more talking and more episode. We should plan a part two at some point. It's been
sure, yeah,
a
if you're
delight
interested.
talking with you. I
Yeah,
would
it's
love
a
to.
joy.
Absolutely.
Sweet.
Yeah. We will plan on it. Did we miss anything that you want to make sure to share before we close out?
I don't think so. As long, I mean, I think I've rambled enough. I don't really know what I just said, but hopefully
Good
it worked
chatting.
out.
Good
Sweet.
stuff. Good stuff.
Good, good,
Yeah.
good.
Thank you so much, Josh. Glad to
Yeah,
talk
man.
with you anytime.
Yeah.
And yeah, if it's okay, I will insert some images of the United Nations comics and things like
Yeah,
that.
I wish you would. Sure. And you know,
Yeah.
some of that stuff are the Living Level 3 stuff. So there's Living Level 3 Iraq, which is the first chapter, and Living Level 3 South Sudan. Those are free in the United States online. So feel free to post links to it and stuff. And if you happen to be in Europe, France and Spain are the only countries in the world that published it in hardback, beautiful
Oh,
copies.
wow.
So,
Wow.
if
Cool.
you read French, you can, it's a nice, beautiful, oversized book. So,
or if you want to experience it across languages, because comics is
yes.
that universal language.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Good callback.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We try. All right.
Sweet.
I'll link those. Absolutely. And again, thank you, and hope to talk again sometime soon.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Great.
Okay, cool.